Political or private.
So the question was, does Brantford have a mechanism for reusing water? We've talked about reuse. I'm always afraid to answer questions because sometimes, most of the time, there's a lot I don't know.
No, it doesn't have to be political.
The answer would be no at the municipal level. Water usage, which we sometimes call gray water. Mm-hmm. So when you turn on the water in Brantford, you get water from the South Central Regional Water Authority. Actually, some of you may have wells in your yard. A lot of residents in Connecticut still have wells, but most of us are on city water. And that water is drinkable. It's up to the best health standards. Okay? So when you're watering your yard, you're using the same quality water. It seems sort of ridiculous, doesn't it? So you can, as an individual homeowner or as an owner of a place like this, you can build onto into your water system gray water systems, but it's not provided in the municipal sense at all.
Or if you do your dishes in a dish pan or something, you could take it out and water your garden instead of using
it. The very typical use is after water is used once, like in a sink or something, it's the sort used for flushing a toilet. Because again, in some very odd way, flushing a toilet with drinkable water seems like sort of silly to do.
But you know,
although dogs don't necessarily think of that.
I think Boru's family in India, I think his father installed a catchment for rainwater.
Yes.
So good. You have a lot of rains. And so I think, isn't that right?
Yeah, they use it for the garden.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of islands that are rocky islands, maybe in Greece, a lot of rural areas like in Hawaii, they'll have catchment systems. In a rainy season, they'll collect all the water and they'll store it in big cisterns underground. They'll have to use it for drinking or farming or whatever they want. That's all the water they have in the dry season.
And sometimes up in Maine, they have what they call cisterns.
Yes, right, where the water is stored. This is a good segue back to the question that I asked, whether you would choose to use this cup or the paper cup. Because in New England, the answer may be very different than in Arizona, for exactly the point you were bringing up. In New England, we have lots of water. Water is not a resource we have to be particularly worried about. So it comes to us for free. We get some water every month of the year. Once in a while, if any of you have lived in this area, how many of you have lived in this area, say, more than 10 years? So you've lived through a drought? Have you lived through
60 years.
Huh?
I've lived here 60 years.
Okay. So what happens when, do you remember any of the drought?
You can't water your lawn.
Right.
You shouldn't wash your car.
You shouldn't wash your car, right.
But it's not taken very seriously and it doesn't last for very long.
Right. So it may be one summer that we have to do.
Right.
So
not even through the entire summer.
Sometimes not even through, yeah. So if we have maybe 2 or 3 years of rainfall that's less than normal, the reservoirs will start going down and we will have one of these droughts where we have to reduce our water use. But it's usually very innocuous, not too. Okay. But in Arizona, New Mexico, they've had drought there now for a couple of years. And you read about, and was it Georgia or South Carolina? Remember there was some reservoir that was drying up, and I think Atlanta was almost about to run out of water.
Atlanta, yeah.
They ended up getting enough water. Mm-hmm. So in areas where water is plentiful, the alternative is, in New England, actually energy is a problem for us. We don't have, energy. What are the sources of energy that humans use? Where's my helpers? What are sources of energy that we use? You know what we burn to make energy?
Gas.
Gas, right? Oil.
Coal.
What else?
Wood.
Where else do we get energy from?
Solar.
Hydro, right? Dams. Oh, you guys are missing a big one in New England. Nuclear, right? We have a lot of nuclear plants,
right.
So a lot of nuclear power. Okay. So New England doesn't have its own source of coal and oil. We do have a lot of wood, and in about 1890, if you looked out over Bayford, you wouldn't have seen a tree. Everything got cut down for forests. The forests got cut down for agriculture, but also the wood was used for building. But everybody had wood-burning stoves. Everybody needed to heat burning wood. And in New England, that was true. If you go to New Hampshire, Vermont, it's very hard to find trees that are older than 120 years old. Since 1900, everything's been going back. If you go up to steep slopes or up on the top of mountains where the loggers didn't get, you can find some very little trees. But New England is a good example where the forest is growing back, which is sort of neat to know. So in New England, the decision as to whether to use a paper cup or this kind of cup might come down to your decision that energies are a more restricted resource than water. There's a very classic example in the industrial ecology as which is less harmful to the environment, the cloth diaper or the paper diaper?
Oh, interesting. Okay. Which one?
Well, it comes a little bit down to what we were just talking about. If you're in a water-rich environment, the cloth diaper works out pretty well because the water is not that expensive, it's not that harmful to the resource, and you can reuse the diaper. The energy that you need to go through each cycle is less, but if water is very scarce and you need it for drinking and agriculture, then you probably would come down on the...
daycare person hated me because I used cloth.
But the real answer is that the industrial ecologists, if they got hold of a question like this, would do this thing called the life cycle analysis. They try to answer all the environmental questions, all the economic questions, and at the end they might say that a disposable diaper is less environmentally harmful. I'm not going to give you the answer, but that's exactly what an industrial ecologist tries to do, answer that question.
Does it make a big difference with the economy? I mean, with what's going on today, does it?
Well, okay, any economists in the group here? Because I'll have to be careful what I say if there are. Okay, so one of the most, for all you youngsters who are thinking about going to school, one of the most exciting fields right now is a field called environmental economics. Okay, so normally economists would say, buy the cheapest thing, because the price integrates everything. The labor, that's why we're buying everything from China, because the labor is really cheap. The problem that environmental economists say is the price isn't always right. So every time there's a subsidy, for instance, then the price is, the manufacturer doesn't have to charge so much, the price is a little lower, and we as consumers will overbuy that commodity because we're not seeing the so-called true price. Now society uses these things, subsidies and taxes all over the place, and part of the reason they're doing it is to manipulate our behavior. So you know that a lot of environmentalists wanted a carbon tax on gas. And the reason is if gas prices went up, as you all know when they did, people actually drive less. That means less carbon dioxide goes in the atmosphere. That means we have to worry a little bit less about global warming. So environmentalists wanted to add a tax to gasoline. Other people didn't want to act. Most consumers want the price of gasoline very cheap. And you have to look at, then it gets very complicated, and we don't want to get into political argument, but then people argue subsidies, so the roads that got built by all society, are they subsidizing the cars? You don't have to, it used to be every major road in New England was a toll road, right? You guys studied U.S. history, colonial history, you know. Roads were owned by private people, and you had to pay to use the road, but they were owned by the state. We used to have to pay taxes to drive on I-95. But now we don't. So the roads get repaved and so on, and so we as drivers, the argument goes, don't see the real price of driving our car.
So is your decision on your life cycle analysis always based on how much it costs?
Well, that was not always, no.
Is it a subjective decision?
It can be subjective at the end, yes.
But it's also, a lot of people look at it in the short term. They don't look at into the future. And they only care about the immediate, I mean their lifetime. Forget about the children. So there's a problem in how to handle this.
And that gets back to this price thing. How do you price something now? You have no idea how to design for instance, PCBs. Mm-hmm. If you wanted to build something, use PCBs 40 years ago, you paid GE and they gave you some PCBs. Now, GE is going to spend $1 billion or something to clean up the Hudson River.